Well, I just have one more little thing, if that's okay.
Oh, yes, of course it is.
But I might need to share the screen.
I think you should be allowed.
Oh, have I got... Oh, share screen, let's see. Clearly, I'm going to have to get much better at this, which, you know, I'm genuinely not the best. Here we go. Let's see if we can get this going.
For those of you that have been before and have had at least one coffee, you'll know that I'm not Tim.
Welcome to Creative Mornings.
So welcome to the second Creative Mornings Derby.
Welcome to Creative Mornings Derby. Welcome to Creative Mornings. Welcome to Creative Mornings, everybody. Welcome to first Creative Mornings. Happy New Year.
Welcome to the very first Creative Mornings Derby.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this slightly unusual edition of Creative Mornings Derby.
Awesome, awesome.
No, thank you. And Tim, I know you've been had gushing thanks already, but I wanted to recognise that 2 years of leading something like Creative Mornings Derby is massive, and it's exhausting and uplifting in equal measure. So massive respect for me. I know Tina, who set up Creative Mornings, and I know that she values everyone's input in terms of the group leadership. So thank you, and good luck to whatever happens next for you, and also for Creative Mornings Derby. And if I can be more involved, I would love to be, because I'm in Derbyshire, right? I'm there. You're there. I'm here. Yeah. So I'm really happy to get more involved. Okay. Thanks. Thank you, everybody. And I always like to start my talks with a cheesy pun. So hello. I'm Mark, and you should be able to hear that okay. Is that clear? Yeah, that's good. That bodes well for the rest of the presentation. So, yeah, I'm Mark, and I'm just literally, I'm on the tip of northwest Leicestershire, Derbyshire, and Staffordshire. I'm literally on three counties here, at four counties, because I've got Warwickshire as well. And I wanted to talk to you today about procrastination, and I started to write this talk on Tuesday, and I just couldn't get going. Like, I once read a book on insomnia, and I never slept for the entire length of the book. And same for this presentation. I just couldn't get going. The procrastination hit. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about procrastination. I'm going to talk to you a lot about 1980s pop music. I might talk to you a little bit about sustainability, creativity, and innovation. And I love that part of that mantra, everyone is creative. And I'll tell you why I love that in a little bit. There's no sales. That's what I do. I'm 52, right? I'm a grandfather now. So I've been doing this for 32 years. I've been doing sustainability and innovation for 32 years. And I've got a handy slide that summarizes all of my career highlights in one go there. And I'll start at the top. Age 9. In Leicestershire schools, I was in a little school called Sharnford C of E, and I took the school out on strike over the quality of the school dinners, because I don't know about you, for some of you, the 1970s, it's just a playlist on your iPhone, right? But for a few of us, it's a real place. And the 1970s were famous for many, many things, really, really crap food and industrial action. And I thought I could unify these two things. So I thought I'd take the whole school out on strike over the quality of the school meals, because our meals were brilliant. We had vitamins. Okay, they were slightly overboiled. All the cabbage was pink, that kind of thing. But they were cooked by real people, and they were whole foods. And I didn't like that. I wanted to bring a little bit of, Arctic roll, a little bit of crispy pancakes, Monster Munch, Primula cheese spread, Tim. A cheese in a tube with chopped up prawns in it that didn't need to be refrigerated. There is nothing in that description that is good, like nothing. And I wanted a bit of that at school. So we marched up and down the playground. We had little signs saying, down with dinners, we want sandwiches. And we would all nick the broomsticks and the mops. There was always a mop in a room, because I guess there was always someone wetting themselves in those days. So we had these signs. I marched up and down the playground for 3 hours. And eventually the management, teachers, gave in. and said, yeah, you can have sandwiches from whenever, 4 weeks' time, 3 weeks' time. So I was really chuffed, strike leader, went home and spoke to my mum and didn't quite tell my mum the truth, because you don't, do you? I said, hey, mum, there's been this thing at school, and as a result, we could all bring sandwiches instead of dinners. And my mum said, oh, that's good, Mark. Some people will be bringing sandwiches. Me and your dad both work, and sometimes we're late home from work, and therefore you have sandwiches for your tea. So you're going to be having a hot dinner every day, and it's going to be at school. So on day one of the new regime, you probably can't see me, I've got my tray, and I'm at the front of the queue, and I'm facing you. That can be you today. I'm facing the only nice dinner lady that ever lived, Mrs. Thomas, and I don't change any of the names, so I apologize for that. And I'm facing Mrs. Thomas, and she's looking at me, and I'm looking at her. And she knew it was me. Everyone knew it was me apart from my mum. And she said, hey, Mark, I'm glad you're still with us. And I said, yes, Mrs. Thomas, very deferential. Yes, Mrs. Thomas. She said, if everybody had dinners, Mark, do you know what would happen? If everybody had sandwiches, Mark, do you know what would happen? I said, no, Mrs. Thomas. She said, I wouldn't have a job, Mark. Richard, her son, Richard wouldn't have a Christmas present. Now, I wasn't that bothered about Richard, but I really cared about Mrs. Thomas. And it was one of those moments that I realized that with great power comes great responsibility. And she was right. Within 3 years, there were no dinner ladies at that school. They were just lunchtime supervisors. And you've got to be super careful with your words and your actions, because they can bring people down. And we're all powerful. And the design and creative community is the most powerful community that there is. We just work for the wrong people sometimes. And then a little bit later than that, or a little bit earlier than that, actually, I got it in the wrong order. I was called by my dad. I was drawing a picture of the Lone Ranger as a competition. I was drawing against Jason Wilborn, who was a brilliant drawer. And my dad came home from work. He was a photographer, you know, wore a cravat at weekends, that kind of chap. And he came home and he looked over my shoulder and he said, if you've got kids, or even if you've got people at work that you work with, that the words really matter. And he looked over my shoulder and he said, what's that supposed to be? And that's the wrong word. The word should be, tell me about your drawing, right? Because that brings people up. What's that supposed to be brings people down. And I said, oh, it's the Lone Ranger. I've got a drawing competition with Jason Wilborn. And he said, oh, Jason Wilborn's a brilliant drawer. You'll never win that. Actually, Mark, you're not the creative one. That's your brother. You're the sciencey rugby playing one. And so I didn't draw from the age of about seven. That was six or seven. I didn't draw from then until I had kids. I had kids quite early. So I was about 23 when we had kids, I think 24. So by the time Daisy started, whose birthday is tomorrow, when Daisy started drawing when she was sort of two, I started drawing again at 26. So I hadn't drawn for 20 years. And guess how I drew? I drew like a six-year-old, because I'd hidden that bit away. And it really matters. And look, creativity and drawing are really different things. And it's really important to know that. In the sixth form, I was in an a cappella heavy metal band called the Purple Wyverns. We were nearly expelled for lots of things, mainly naked performances at lunchtime. So we don't talk about that anymore. And I still see them. And they all live in Hinckley or Nottingham. And then at university in the 80s, remember the 80s? Great music. And I was paid, just listen, kids, I was paid to go to universities. To university. I was paid £2,100 a year and no fees, but I still had an overdraft. So I went to work my overdraft off at Tesco's at Hinckley in the summer holidays in the distribution warehouse. And the 1980s were great for music, but they were pretty shit in South Africa for black people. There was this thing called apartheid that was utterly broken, and I was part of the Midlands anti-apartheid movement. It's a relatively small chapter, but we were active, and we were avoiding South African produce. And I got asked by the Tesco's person to move some apples, and I went down to pick them up and I looked at them, and they've got Cape produce of South Africa on. And I dithered, and he saw me dithering, and he said, you're right. And I went, nah, not really. There's this thing called apartheid. It's morally bankrupt, broken and wrong. And these apples come from that place and I'm not eating them. So I don't want to move them. And he said, are you on strike? And I stood and thought about it. And I thought, well, if you stand for nothing, you'll fall for anything. Yeah, I'm on strike, I said. And about 30 people behind me, all the other temps, went, yeah, we're with Mark. We're on strike as well. Shit. How has this happened twice in a decade? And to be fair, he was really good, right? Tesco's were great. They went, it's a really complex issue. No, it's not. It's dead simple. There are lots of people with no morals. I'll get some of them to move the apples. Mark, you're in the meat freezer for 3 days. And that's a true story. They gave me protective equipment, but I was down at like minus 13 for 3 days. But if you stand for nothing, you fall for anything. I was head of sustainability for ASDA after university, which was really interesting, but I was too early. It's like 99, 2000. They didn't want to do things that I wanted to do, like solar panels on every roof, delivery of goods by boat, sustainable urban drainage, reduced packaging, organic range. Those things were not on their card. They were brilliantly normal 3 years later, but at that point they were really radical. I ran an eco-design agency in Leicestershire for 10 years. I helped my friend, well, my friend David and Claire, they set up the Do Lectures, and about three or four of us came in to, as supporting members or founding partners. So I did that. I'm still a founding partner, but we've not been active for a couple of years because of the COVID. So that happened. I wrote a book called Do Disrupt. I now run an agency called Ape, where we help big companies think small, vice versa. Sustainability, that's the one. Sustainability and innovation. Combined, which we'll talk about today. Got a side project where I make hot sauce. I wrote another book called Do Present, about putting out your, it's actually not about presentation skills, and it sounds like it is. It's about working out who you are so that you can project the right you, so you can make a bigger impact. And another side project I've got is Reasons to be Cheerful, where we published amazing blogs, run great events, and we published a book, that book there, and a newspaper. So we got a newspaper of good cheer as well. So that's me, that's what I do. That took longer than I thought, so I have to speed up. Procrastination. Right, I'm gonna talk a bit about this all the way through, but I'm just gonna flag two concepts of time before I do that. The Greeks, super clever. They actually had three concepts of time, but the two main ones were chronos, chronological time, the tick versus tock versus tick versus tock of time as it sweeps past you. When you're young, time is about right, right? Teenager, you might want time to go a bit quicker so you can get to 18 so you can drink legally, or 16 so you can have sex legally. Does anyone bother about these things anymore? I don't know. And then in your 20s, in the party decade where you're out, and maybe you want the weekends to go a bit slower and the week to go a bit quicker, but actually time's moving at the right pace. Your 30s, you might have kids, you might not. That time feels good as well. And then you hit 40 and some fucker turns time up. So you're now on super fast, right? You're now on one, listening to something on Audible on 1.5 times, right? Suddenly time's whizzing by, and no matter how you hold on to the hands of time, no matter how much weight you put on those hands, they will not slow down. And then you retire from what to what? Don't retire, it's a fucking trap. When you retire, you die, right? There is a direct correlation. Every single person that retires dies. Therefore, do not retire. It's causal. And you panic that you've not done everything you want to do, right? So chronological time is a real challenge. The Kairos version of time, it's really interesting. That's much more seasonal, much more cyclical. Seasons, women's cycles, lunar, all of those things, much more important. But Kairos means there's a time for you to do your thing. There's a perfect time for everything. So Colonel Sanders did not start slaughtering chickens on a colossal scale until he was in his late 50s. Harrison Ford was not discovered as an actor of merit until he was 35, which is old. Sometimes time is waiting for you, and you can stop waiting for time. So maybe there's something in procrastination that's not all bad. I'll come on to that in a minute. Okay, so I'm going to take you through my timeline of life, and I'm going to talk a little bit about sustainability, and I'm going to talk a little bit about procrastination. This is me aged about 5 in Leicestershire in a spacesuit, because that was going to be the future, and I loved every minute of life, as you should at 5. I did not procrastinate. Life was there for the taking. The 70s, we had a few strikes, we nearly had socialism, we had some shit food, and we had this thing called punk. And punk was amazing, and it was exactly the right time. It felt like we'd been procrastinating for 3 years. At the end of glam rock, talk about music a lot, at the end of glam rock, there was this thing called prog rock, which was neither progressive or rock. It was really detailed, incredibly talented musicians who played guitar solos that took an hour. You could get yourself to De Montfort Hall for a prog rock night. You could realize you'd left the kettle on back in Hinckley. You could leave the band as the guitar solo started. You could get all the way back to Hinckley, turn the kettle off, and come all the way back to the De Montfort Hall, and they were still on the same guitar solo, right? That was nothing progressive. And then suddenly, this thing broke, and it was called punk. And it was driven not just by the dreadfulness of prog rock, because that's innovation. You react to what came before. But it was also driven, by time, by this need to do something different. And it sounded amazing. The first punk band in the world were actually the Ramones. Punk didn't start in Britain. It started in America. First punk band in Britain was the Damned, and they sounded like this.
Is she really going out with him?
The thing is, diversity is strength, and punk only started to sound better when women got involved. And Susie arrived and made everything better. And it's still punk, and it still mattered. So at this point, procrastination began, and it was all around Sundays and homework. Oh, I put it off. Then I did it really quick and made a mess of it. And I was living in Coventry, actually, not long before this. My grandparents were still from there. So although we'd moved to Leicestershire, we used to go back to Coventry, and this amazing thing happened in Coventry called SCAR, called Two Tone, because diversity is strength. And when you want to run factories with immigrant labor, you bring over the people and their hands, and they come with a brain and they come with a culture, and that culture blended beautifully with punk. And you had this incredible musical movement called ska, and it was stunning. You've still got this punk, you've still got this kind of need to rebel, but you've got some melody in there, and it makes everything better. So at this point, I was procrastinating on the things that I didn't like, the things that I thought I'd be judged about, the things that people saw in me. And I'm just going to flip to sustainability at this point as well, because at this point I joined Greenpeace, and I became aware of the sustainability movement, which I thought we were procrastinating on. So things began to get really exciting for me, and I began to find a little bit of a purpose, and new romantics happened. Now, look, I mean, I'm 52, right? Given the chance, I'd still wear eyeliner when I went out. I love all this stuff, right? A bit of blush, bit of eyeliner, fucking all over that. Who doesn't want to go out with these two, right? I don't even know where they're going. I'm going with them, right? This is amazing. And the new romantics was a reaction to punk, that sort of cut down, sparse, amazing music you could make in your bedroom, which was a reaction in turn to prog rock. This was a more flamboyant look and a more flamboyant melody, and everything was incredibly embellished. And I loved it. And look, you listen to this track by Visage, and there's no way that you're not dancing. That bit. You're dancing. Bubbles, Hinkley, 1981. That was me. But like everything good, if you don't change, it becomes bad. And I'm not knocking Duran Duran. I'm not knocking them at all. But they came from Birmingham, which is a great Midlands town, city, obviously, and they're amazing bands. But they stopped changing after album 2, and it took them till album 10 before they started changing again. However, they did sound like this. And the time was right. I mean, who would have thought you'd have had one of the biggest bands in the world coming out of a club in Birmingham called the Rum Runner? Like, there's nothing on paper that would make that happen. The timing was perfect. But they were frustrated. They'd already tried 2 or 3 times to make a go of it. Nothing happened. They were on their third lead singer. Stephen Tintin Duffy was, I think, their first lead singer. At this point, I discovered the Smiths, and I discovered Newcastle Brown. Because I'm Pedigree Beer, by the way. And I loved it. I absolutely loved it. And the reaction to that overblown new romantic stuff is to go back to guitars and simplicity again. And suddenly music for me became really exciting. Now, I'm not saying Morrissey is a great man now, but I'm saying as a musical movement, him and Mar created something incredible. But no matter how much I tried dancing on one leg with a flower sticking out my back pocket, I wasn't getting any of the girls. The people that were getting all the girls looked like this. And this, I fought the wars of call against these kind of people, but actually when you listen to it in history, when you listen to it with some irony, it's actually quite good. I actually quite like hair metal in retrospect, but at the time, I'm going to play this, you're all going to love it, and then I'm going to feel foolish, which is what happens every single time I use the picture of Europe and play the final countdown.
Hello,
And you're loving that, and that's okay, right? And I understand that no matter what I thought at the time, there's a perfect time for everything. There really is. And, you know, that hair metal stuff stood the test of time really well. So then I went to university, right? I went to university in 88, went to Bradford, and I'd already hit some procrastination. I'd managed to fail my GCSE, my A-levels, and I had to take another year. I had 3 years in sixth form, utterly shaming. Got to play rugby for another year, went to university at exactly the right time. Because I went to university at the time that the Stone Roses happened and at the time the Chicago House hit. I procrastinated then. I've procrastinated every single deadline. I needed the buzz of last minute effort. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. I'm just going to play the Stone Roses because look at me, I'm 52 and they run through me like the words Blackpool through a stick of rock. And they sound like this. The thing is, we need better heroes. Just look at Brown now. Look at what Brown's saying now. Look at Morrissey now. Look at what Morrissey's saying now. Musically, yeah, I'm on one. We need heroes that stand for something bigger than them. I really, really loved Public Enemy. And I'd loved Public Enemy since about 1984, 85, because they were arguing for something that was bigger than them and they were scary. And this was overdue and they sounded incredible.
Brothers and sisters! Brothers and sisters, I don't know what this world is coming to.
And in some kind of beautiful synergistic link, I went to see the Stone Roses on one of their comeback tours about 4 years ago, and they were supported by Public Enemy. That's right. 30,000 middle-aged men could not walk for a week because they'd done themselves a mischief dancing to one or other of the others. And then I went on my placement year, and I managed to time the cycle from Muswell Hill to Camden perfectly, so I was always 30 minutes late. Always exactly 30 minutes late. Procrastinated every morning. Beautiful time to be in London. I had some really good friends, one of which was the sister of Damon Albarn from Blur. So I ended up being in that really early Britpop thing, which was lovely. And I've actually, in this year, I found myself. This was an important year. You all know what Britpop sounded like. This was 91 when I was there. It didn't really explode till 94, but you could feel it. You could feel it. Bands like Gene were beginning to happen long before Elastica. Pulp were already there, and of course, Blue. And amazing, really, really amazing. And then I got married really young, got married at university, had kids early, and got a good job, big job, proper job. And work was tough, it's hard. And I procrastinated the admin, and that difference between progressive and maintenance tasks was really clear in my mind. I was creative. I finally worked that out. And I loved the things that moved me forward, and I hated the things that seemed dull. So I procrastinated the wrong things. And I'll always remember being interviewed by at John Cleveland College in Hinckley. I was interviewed by the principal one year, and he said, "How are you getting on?" I said, "Good." He said, "How are you getting on with French?" I said, "I hate French." He said, "How are you getting on with maths?" I said, "I love maths." He said, "Which homework do you do first?" I said, "Maths." And he said, "Yeah, do French first, do the hard one first, do the one you hate first." And there's a lesson in procrastination right there. Look, then new rave happened. It's not for me, but it sounded good. And it was needed, and it was a reaction to what came before, and it was perfect time for kids. Now, I grew up with Chicago House and an early rave. And kids of that era needed something else. We all need something else. To roll on a few years, what's happened? Well, we've democratized creativity. We've democratized retail. We've had third wave feminism, and there's more of that to come. Gig economy, capitalism 2.0. I'm listening to Run the Jewels at the moment, and I'm working to help others understand their procrastination. And I don't mean about time. I mean about the barriers to them as people, because that's a form of procrastination. I'm going to talk a bit about that later. So I'm listening to Run the Jewels. You don't need me to play Run the Jewels, do you? Of course you do. Everyone needs to listen to Run the Jewels every single day. That should be playing. Run the Jewels, Atlanta, New York, DJ, rapper, Killer Mike. A real leader, because they're rapping about something bigger than themselves, things that really matter. Salt, another band doing amazing work in that area. And when you can turn the TV on and you can see this happening at the Brit Awards, you know, stuff's getting better.
tip of my pen tell. No fear, I'ma let the tip of my pen show. That like, yo, Theresa May, where's that money for Grenfell? Well, you thought we just forgot about Grenfell, you criminals.
And it really, really matters. And then roll on 2 years, we've got Leicester's finest. Well, actually, he's not Leicester's finest, he's Streatham's finest, but he went to Leicester, De Montfort University. We got Dave doing exactly the same thing in his own way with Blackies. Incredible performance. And it's time for a change, as it was with punk. And at the same time as punk in America, we had the Sugar Hill Gang. We had this whole kind of development of what I would call kind of, I won't call it black punk, that sounds wrong, but a movement within the black world that was about being able to make music where you were. You didn't need the skills to do it. You just needed some enthusiasm and a sampler and a hip hop beat, which you could use your mouth for. It really mattered to be able to put the power of creativity into normal people's hands matters. But a little bit on procrastination. So what is procrastination? You may want to know, you may not know this, but it's from the Latin. It means there's a Latin word that sits behind it, meaning to put off until tomorrow. This is not due to a lack of time, but actually more often thought to be due to difficult emotions associated with a task, or the way that I work in my workshops, to do with a limiting belief of yourself and what those emotions stop you doing. And look, we all procrastinate because we feel uncomfortable on some kind of emotional level. We're holding off, and we all do it all the time. But what sits behind that? It's fear. Fear of failure, fear of success, fear of what next, and fear of being visible. So it's fear of change and it's fear of being seen. Change is bloody inevitable. The problem comes when the world changes and you haven't. So don't fear change. It's boring. It's like a management consultant's mantra, a motivational speaker's mantra. Change is a constant. Yes, it is. Don't feel it. You've got to, it's going to happen. Fear it. It's going to happen anyway. You might as well orchestrate it. You might as well be part of it. And then not being seen. What do we do to ourselves when we make ourselves small? Why do we render ourselves invisible? Why would you take away your own voice? Why would you do that? And yet we do it all the time. So these two things don't serve us at all. But I then got thinking about what are the benefits of procrastination, because I still procrastinate. I did with this presentation. I finished it very, very late last night. So what are the benefits of procrastination? And there are a few, right? So procrastination, time efficient. If you can do more in the same hours, right? You type faster when your laptop battery's running out, right? That you can get more done if you procrastinate, but can you get it done as well? These are questions. They're not statements, right? Leaving it to the last minute saves rework due to a changing. You all know what brief creep's like. You do all your work. The client comes back and says, actually, I've changed my mind. If you leave it to the last minute, none of that stuff matters, right? So there's some sense in that as well, maybe. And then once you're a master of procrastination, you can do what you're doing safe in the knowledge that you're going to put it out of the bag, because you always do, until the time that you always don't. And greater time can bring a bigger number of ideas. You can sit in the problem better. I'll talk a bit about how you have better ideas in a minute, but being able to sit in the problem for longer is not always a problem. It's often a solution. And it can also bolster this image of you as a rebel. This kind of like, oh, yeah. He always leaves it to the last minute, but he pulls it out of the bag every time. And people get a bit of vibe off that. Although in ancient Greece, procrastination was seen as a sign of affluence and leadership. You had the time to luxuriate in a decision. Is that procrastination, or is that just taking a good run-up at something? Very, very different things. And then landing it at the last minute, you know, you get that adrenaline rush, that, oh yeah, nailed it. That was tough, tight. But be careful, this is addictive. This is a massive serotonin release. This can lead to a cycle that requires later and later submission, greater and greater procrastination. But here's the really dangerous one. You can build your own savior. You can be a DIY savior, but nearly derailing yourself, you can then give yourself a jolly good pat on the back for saving the situation. And I see this all the time in large organizations. And people do it because of all of those things. The adrenaline rush is the weird one, is the addictive one. Be careful of that. But there could also be really significant limiting beliefs at play here. I can't get anything on time. I'm just not that kind of person. And I guess you've all seen the video, the Pike's, I can't see you, but I'm guessing you've all seen the video, the Pike syndrome, at some point over your lives, but I'll summarize it really quickly. Mobius in 1846 did an experiment with a pike, big fish, a carnivorous fish, underbite, eats other fish, right? Put it in a massive tank, put lots of little fish in there. The big ear fish ate the little fish. He then moved the pike out of the way and put in a glass bell jar, open at the top, open at the bottom, lowered that down. The water fills the bell jar. The pike's on the outside, nothing's on the inside. He then puts lots of little fish on the inside. The big fish sees the little fish, runs at it, swims at it, can't run in water, swims at it, clouts its snout on the front of the glass bell jar, does that for like an hour, can't get to the little fish, gets depressed, sinks to the bottom, looks all demoralized. Mobius then takes the bell jar out, lifts the bell jar out, puts it over here. The little fish swim everywhere. The pike doesn't move. The little fish swim across the top, down the side, and across the snout of the pike. The pike doesn't even try and eat the little fish because its constraining belief is that it can't eat the little fish. And if you don't shift the pike out of that environment, if you don't move it, the pike will die of starvation, surrounded by food. We go bankrupt, surrounded by amazing opportunities. We run out of great ideas, surrounded by the best talent in the world, because we don't think we deserve it. You sit there, not able to answer a brief or to do a piece of work, procrastinating on it because you don't think you can do it. You can. Removing that and that limiting belief is so, so important. Now, I want to talk to you about three things to procrastinate on, because these are the things that I work with: presentation and voice, sustainability, creativity. And remember, creativity, my definition is imagining a world that hasn't arrived yet. Let's not procrastinate that, right? But when you're writing a presentation, procrastinating on presentations, what's that about? So some good stuff here and there's some bad stuff here. Leaving a talk to the last minute ensures that you've got like really up-to-date information. It keeps the talk fresh in your mind. No matter if you procrastinate writing it, you should always leave space. I always leave a chunk when I write my presentations. I have a chunk in there, which is just about flexibility and stuff that's about to happen now or is going to happen. And I can be on the train on the way somewhere and read something and then pop that in. I was in Greece once doing a presentation in Athens, and I managed to get a piece into the presentation from the 9 o'clock news in the morning, 9 a.m. news on breakfast TV, had subtitles, into my presentation. Now that's amazing, right? So procrastination with presentations is not always a problem. What about sustainability? Well, from that little boy who was 10, joined Greenpeace for the first time, right the way through to the person that studied environmental science at university, right the way through to the rise of the Green Party in 1989 in the local elections, right the way through to the collapse of sustainability in the 90s as economic growth took hold and we forgot the stuff that matters, to the rise of the awareness around climate change and plastic. Climate change is way more important than plastic, like way more. The three biggest threats to the sea: Number one, climate change, ocean acidification. Number two, overfishing. You've probably seen Seageddon or whatever it's called. I can't remember what it's called, but that's really important. Number three is ocean debris. And as part of ocean debris, a very small slither of that is plastic. It really matters. Don't put it in the ocean. But the antibiotics and the manures and the fertilizers we use on our farm that run into the sea every day are much more damaging, but they're much less visible. So don't procrastinate sustainability, because we've got no time. It's time to wake up on that. I mean, everyone. The problem with the plastic debate is it allows you to focus on straws, not the Audi Q7 that you're driving around a city. It allows you to focus over here, not over here. And this is little and that's big. So we need to stop pissing about on sustainability. And then procrastinating innovation. Look, I know it's really hard to timetable innovation and creativity. I know it's hard to plan great ideas. Or is it? You can create the environment for sustainable innovation and creativity by doing three things. You ask a better question. Don't ask, there's a really good example here, a deodorant can. This was an example that is real, a genuine one. I won't tell you the companies, but you can probably guess them. So with one of the world's largest deodorants, the brief to the designers were, I want you to, we want to sell 20% more. 20% more of this, please. And the designers, who are dead famous, one of the biggest design companies in the world, product design companies, went away and came back and said, we've solved it, we can solve you 20%, but sell 20% more. And they made the hole in the nozzle 20% bigger. And now the thing is, only 16%, less than 16% of what you spray out of that nozzle goes on you, the rest gets breathed in. So actually, by making a more direct, better nozzle, you can get more product transfer. And then you can put 20% less product in the can because you've got greater transfer of product. So then you can make the cans 20% smaller for the same price. So the real question is not how do we sell 20% more, it's how do we make 20% more profit and still deliver great consumer value? That's the real question. Then talk to people who aren't like you. Diversity is a strength. Talk to other people. And then finally, and the one that links to procrastination, is meditation. As we sit in meditation, and I don't mean om, but I may mean om. This could be riding your bike. This could be in the shower. As we sit in meditation, we move from beta into alpha and into theta brainwaves. And when we're in theta brainwaves, that's when we're our most creative. That's the magic. So every single one of you has got a superpower, but I doubt that procrastination is the superpower. Some of the things that come with procrastination could be getting in your way. And yet, taking time to answer the right question in the right way, now that might be your superpower. So I want you to go back to my first story, that little boy with his tray in front of the dinner lady. That was me. And that realization that with great power comes great responsibility. And every single one of us in the creative industries has that responsibility and has that power. So it's time to wake up. It's time to take action that is more aligned with something that is bigger than you. And it's time to remember that every one of us is creative and we've got to do something powerful with it. And my only advice to you with your superpower is to be a little more left and a little less right. That isn't a political statement. Honest. Over to you, Tim.
Amazing. Thank you very much, Mark.